Today, we have with us Professor Ravindran from Central University of Tamil Nadu. He is a professor in physics and head at Simulation Center for Atomic and Nanoscale Materials, SCANMAT, at Central University of Tamil Nadu. He took his PhD in solid state physics from Anna University and his postdoctoral studies from Uppsala University, Sweden, University of Oslo, Norway, and Center for Materials Science and Technology, University of Oslo, Norway. He joined the Department of Physics, School of Basic and Applied Sciences, Central University of Tamil Nadu as a faculty member in 2012 and now is a full professor. He has guided over 15 research students for PhD work. His research interests are electronic structure studies on solids using solid state or density functional methods. This is a short biography, and with this I invite Professor Ravindran for his lecture. Sir, please.
Yeah, thank you very much for the nice introduction. This talk I prepared a little primitive, like that, because a lot of master students may be attending. But yes, yes. Finally, I will give some of our research activities, some related to the solar energy materials or optical properties of materials used to design new material for practical applications. Okay, like that I plan. As he mentioned, I am from Central University of Tamil Nadu. My activities can be seen in University of Oslo website still. Okay, there I have put recent publications and our research activities, etc. So I have given this web link. There you can look what are the activities we are doing. Okay, so our research is mainly focused on energy and environmental friendly technology, whatever material we use. So for that, we are working on various functional materials. The reason is the sustainable development goals targeted for 2030 involve no poverty, no hunger, food health, renewable energy, climate action, life on land, life below water, all these things are some way connected to environmental friendly energy utilization. Okay, so then we want to develop new technologies. For that technology, we need materials with properties beyond current state of the art with higher efficiency and etc. So that is why we are working on new materials for energy technologies. So I show some slides. Here one slide show the energy use per capita versus GDP per capita. That means if you are rich, obviously you consume more energy. So everybody want to climb this ladder, then you want to be more rich, then obviously we will use more energy. But currently we are using mainly fossil fuel, then obviously we damage the environment, so we want to avoid that one. Okay, the another interesting slide here, they have plotted in the Indian perspective this energy consumption per capita with versus the life expectancy. The life expectancy increases as we increase the electricity consumption. So then because of that, the Homi Bhabha said there is no power as costly as no power. So then we want to live long, we have to consume more energy. So then utilizing more energy is essential, but we want to do it in environmental friendly way. That is the challenge. Okay, so then when we consume more energy, obviously the global warming and other effects are there. Then here they have given some typical example. Well, suppose we increase the temperature from the pre-industrial level to 2 degrees centigrade, what are the consequences of that increasing temperature will cause? So we know that risk of coastal flooding, risk of hunger, all these things, that is we are aware. Then also due to limited water available, water shortage, that will cause more people suffering. This is also most of us know, but we not much aware the risk of increase in the infectious disease when the global warming increase, temperature increase. Because temperature increase, the microorganisms also thrive. Then obviously various new diseases will emerge. Maybe that may be one of the reason why we are now end up with SARS, MERS, and now COVID and all these things. So then it is important we want to consume more energy in an environmental friendly way, and then we want to create something called sustainable energy system. then current system is unsustainable. There we mainly use majority of the energy consumed through using the fossil fuel, that is also available limited reserve only. Then when we burn that one, we will introduce the environment pollutant, CO2, water, all these things. That time we consume oxygen. Okay, this is an unsustainable energy cycle. We want to move away from this to go to this the sustainable energy system, where renewable energy sources we will use to produce electricity, or hydrogen will be produced by electrolysis process or photocatalytic water reduction process. I will tell what is that photocatalytic water reduction. So in this way, that time we will consume some water from the environment, and then we will release the oxygen and only take out hydrogen. Then we will use that one in the utilization point in terms of in the form of combustion engine or fuel cell. That time how much water we take in, that exactly that amount of water will be bring it back to the normal. There is no pollutant on involved on this process. So that is why this is a sustainable energy system. This is what we are aiming for. For that, we have a lot of material challenges to produce efficient way electricity from renewable energy sources, like solar cell technology, or then decomposing water to produce hydrogen, etc., and fuel cell where we efficiently harvest the energy to utilization point. All these things we need to develop new material. Okay, for that we are working on a group of people on various aspects of materials directly or indirectly linked to environmental friendly energy technology. There we people work on photocatalyst, multiphoric materials used for sensor, etc., solar cells, battery materials, hydrogen storage material, thermoelectric material, like that various aspects of materials used for energy technology we are using, we are studying. So I will today, then I will tell some of our results in the last section of my today talk. So we study, use ab initio method called density functional theory. Then we study wide range of properties listed here, like magnetic properties, lattice dynamic properties, superconductivity, multiphoric, wide range of properties study. This work I will focus something on the optical properties, that is theme of this colloquium. So I will focus on that. So then when we our goal is to describe the properties of matter from theoretical method, firmly rooted in some fundamental equation. What are those equation? I will show you that. With that we will study almost all properties of material, like structural, electronic, magnetic, optics, vibrational properties, etc. Okay. So then we want to develop some theory. So we know that solids contain atom, atoms have electron and nucleus, all these things well known. But then you know, if we take 1 kilo of gold, for instance, that is contain this much 10^24 atoms are there in the so then you know, this is a very huge number of atoms there. Then each atom, there is lot of electrons there, then the electrons will be interact each other. Then we want to study the dynamics of electron and calculate their energetics. We want to count all the interaction between electrons with other electron, and electron with ions, and ion with ions, and all these things. Then we have to consider all these terms into our Hamiltonian matrix, like kinetic energy of electron, electron-ion interaction, electron-electron interaction, ion-ion interaction, kinetic energy of ion, all these things to be accounted. Okay, this is a many-body problem. It is impossible to track computationally. So that is why we have to do some simplification. We know that the nucleus is much heavier than electron. So then we can assume that the dynamics of nucleus is negligible compared to the electron. So the kinetic energy of electron will be much higher because of the light weight. Then we can ignore the kinetic energy coming from the nucleus. Then we assume that the nucleus are stationary, and with respect to this nuclear position, the electrons are move with the Chetan velocity, like that. So then we can decouple electron dynamics from the nuclei, like that. Okay, this is a usually called von Oppenheimer approximation. I am not mentioning that here, but this is what we want to do. Still, it is in the electron-electron interaction is a many-body problem that is very difficult to handle. It is impossible for a realistic system. So then we assume that electrons move in some kinds of effective potential. Then we treat each electron as an independent particle. They move in some kinds of effective potential. Okay. Then now we want to calculate what is that effective potential is. That we will do it through some ab initio method. That is, we call it first principle method. There we just want the atomic number and the electronic configuration. Then we can able to calculate this effective potential for this one electron Hamiltonian matrix mentioned here. Okay, so then in this independent particle picture, then the kinetic energy can be expressed in terms of the wave function through this particular relation. Then when the Kohn-Sham energy equation can contain the kinetic energy term, then the external potential term that contain the electron ion interaction, all these things. Then the Hartree potential, that is nothing but the electron Coulombic repulsion term. Then also whatever things left in the, you know, we are making a lot of approximation, then the many body effect, whatever left other than these three terms, those things are kept in the those things are kept in the exchange correlation part of the things. Then our potential, Kohn-Sham potential contain external potential, Hartree potential and exchange correlation potential. So our challenge is to calculate the exchange correlation part. Okay, there is no explicit functional form available for this exchange correlation term. All the other terms, they are depend upon the local electron density, and these things are already derived. For the exchange correlation part, there are several approximations there. One approximation is called local density approximation. There they says that the exchange correlation energy is dependent upon the local electron density of the system. Okay, if we know the electron density at a particular point r, we know, then we are able to calculate the exchange correlation part of the energy through this relation, where this epsilon xc homogeneous, this term is the 1 minute, I will put this, this term is the electron energy, homogeneous electron system, the exchange correlation energy per particle, that we can already derived for the homogeneous electron gas. So this is we know, then we know local electron density, we can able to calculate this one. Okay, there are several form of this local density approximations there, like Parth, Kadian, Kadian Linguist, like that, several schemes there. Among that, the popular scheme is given by Perdue Wang. So there are different schemes. This this particular part, this exchange correlation part of a homogeneous electron system, they've done some kinds of parameterization. People done a different way of these parameterizations. That way, there are several LDA schemes are there. Okay, so then we have all the terms in these equations we know, then we are able to set up the Hamiltonian matrix and solve and study the properties of the material. Okay, when they do that one, then they found that the LDA underestimate the bond length and etc. So then instead of the local electron density, they also accounted the gradient of the charge density into the equation to estimate the exchange correlation term. Then this is called generalized gradient approximation that give improved binding energy and etc. But still the band gap, that is one of the important quantity needed to study the optical property, that band gap will come 30 to 50% smaller than the experimental band gap is. So that is why we have to use a different approach. Then one approach is the hybrid functional approach. There the hybrid functional approach, they will take the correlation part of the potential from GGA and then 20% of the exchange part from GGA calculation, and 70% of the exchange part will be derived from Hartree-Fock method. Okay, so then this is, that is why they call hybrid functional. Those things give very, really very good band gap value, etc. But the problem is the computational time involved will be. Okay, suppose you want to finish the calculation, you do it with the GGA 1 hour, you want to do hybrid function calculation, it may take 1 week like that. Okay, that way computation time increase, but you can able to calculate the optical band gap, etc. very accurately with the hybrid functional calculation. Okay, so now we will look at the overall view, the Schrodinger view. We have many electrons, they will be interact themselves. So these are very complicated things. Okay, so the electron moving, this kinds of potential mentioned here. Instead of that, a DFT view, we are having an independent particle. These are called Pontian particles. They are non-interacting to each other, but they move in some kinds of effective potential like that. Okay, this is a easy to solve problem because if number of electron is n, then the computation time will be involved scale with the number of particle power 5. But in this case, it will be number of particle power 3, or even there are new methodology developed there. It will be scale, computation time will be scale with the number of particle power 2, etc. like that. Okay, for this in the local density Pontian development equations development with the LDA and other thing, the Nobel Prize was awarded in 1992 development of the density functional theory to Walter Cohen from University of California and John Popple for his developing the quantum chemistry related stuffs in the density functional theory. Okay, so then the practically what usually we do, we take some guess charge density, that is maybe atomic charge density usually we will take. Then using that, we will construct the effective potential. Then we know we substitute that one in the some Pontian equation, that is, the Schrodinger-like equation where, independent particle like that, there, Pontian equation we call it. Then we solve this one, then we calculate wave function. From the wave function, we can calculate the charge density. Now we got new charge density corresponding to this effective potential. Then we check whether it achieve the self-consistency, that is a previous iteration or present iteration, the difference in the charge density, that is within the tolerable limit, then we will assume that self-consistency is achieved, then we will derive all the properties what we are interested in, like total energy, the stress forces, optical properties, electronic structure, whatever things needed, all these things we will do. Otherwise, we will again take this new charge density and construct the effective potential, solve the Pontian equation and calculate the electron density like that. This iteration will be done like this in computers. So usually, lot of mass use parallel computational codes are available. This diagonalization process are done in supercomputers with multiple nodes that may sometime run for weeks and months to obtain the solutions, depend upon the problem at hand. Okay. So here I have some results. Okay, if you do the calculation, you are able to predict the equilibrium volume within 1 to 3%. You do calculate the pressure into its phase transition, that we can get it within 10%. Usually it underestimate 10% with LDA, GG around 550 kilobar, like R5 GPA difference we can predict. The band gap, unfortunately, LDA and GGA 30 to 50% underestimate. That is why we will use the GW method or the hybrid functional method I have shown earlier. Okay, so then here they have given a comparison of experiment and with the theory on theoretical volume, transition pressure and band gap value between experiment and theories they have given. Okay, now we calculated the charge density and the potential of a converged system. Then we want to study the electron structure. Why we want to study the electron structure? We want to calculate, for instance, optical property. We want to know how the electrons are energetically distributed in the momentum space as the K space. That is called the band structure or the electron structure. So we will not do the band structure any randomly. We will actually plot the band structure in the high symmetry direction in the irreducible part of the Brillouin zone. Okay, this polyhedra what shown here is the first Brillouin zone of the FCC lattice. Okay, like copper, silicon, everything is having FCC structure. Then they have this particular Brillouin zone. Then we actually take the irreducible part of the Brillouin zone, that is this pink color stuff shown here. Then we use group theory or apply the symmetry, we are able to fill the entire Brillouin zone using this particular stuff. Then using Bloch's equation theorem, then we are able to calculate the properties of the entire crystal from this. If we know the information from the irreducible birth of the possible Ansoni submission. Okay. So then here there are some high symmetry points there. Always the center of the Bulanzoni is the gamma point, that is Kx, Ky, Kz, all are zero. Every Bulanzoni, there are 14 Bulanzonis are there in the three-dimensional solids. So then there are 14 Bulanzonis only there. So every Bulanzoni, there will be a center, that center point is gamma point. Okay, then any band structure you look, you will mostly see the gamma point will be there. Why we will plot the band structure in the high symmetry points? Those high symmetry direction only where the band extremas will be there, that is like valence band maxima, conduction band minima, all these things are there. Those are our interest for studying optoelectronic properties, etc. That is why we plot usually that. Okay, here we plot the band structure, like, you know, W to gamma. Okay, W, where is it? You know, W is here, gamma is here. Okay, then this W to gamma, this point we plot. Then we, you know, each point we calculate the electronic energy level, and then we put this point, then move another one K point, then calculate the eigenvalues and put like that, then connect the eigenvalues. We will get something called this band structure. Okay, if it is the atomic state, we will get some discrete energy level, no, atomic energy level. Now, because the electrons are wave functions are overlapping, they are moving in a crystal potential. Then they will have feel different energy in a different direction in the crystal, because the potential in the crystal, three-dimensional crystal, will be different in a different direction. That is why W gamma W point, we will have energy of the electron different from gamma to X point, like that. It is changing. So that is why we will have point dispersion will be there, that will be different along different directions. Okay, so this is a band structure of silicon. I will show the band structure of copper. Copper is having d electron. D electrons are, the d orbitals are dumbbells like shape. Then their overlap interaction will be minimum. So then they will behave almost like a well localized case, like atomic, like that. So because atomic like picture is there, then we will have very narrow band or discrete energy levels you will get from the d electron. But the outermost s electrons are spherically symmetric, then they will form overlap with the neighboring s orbital. Then the electron get overlap, broad bands will be there, or band dispersion will be more. That is why we will have some s band, and that will be extended. You know, it is usually partial field. So then that will cross at the Fermi level. Fermi level is the topmost occupied energy level that separates the valence band to conduction band. So then, these electrons, those are crossing the partially filled band is there, that is from the S electron, those participate in the electrical conductivity in copper. So that is why copper is a metal. On the other hand, here, there is a gap separating the valence band and conduction band, then we will have a semiconducting behavior here, okay? So here now we look aluminium, very sp solid, there is no d electron, that is why we are having well dispersed band. Okay, totally 2 s electron, 1 p electron, totally 3 electron only there. So then, each band, we can occupy 2 electron, 1 up electron, 1 down electron, total 2 electron will fill in each band. Then we end up with, there are 3 electron, 1 and half band only filled. So that is why we will have partial occupancies there. Why we are having, see here, 4 band, 1, 2, 3, 4 band. Because there is a 2 s electron and 6 p electron, total 8 electrons can be possible to accommodate in the aluminium outermost orbitals. But only 2 or 3 electron occupy 1.5 band, then remaining are unoccupied band. Okay, some direction we will see only 3 band, and some k point we see 4 band. The reason is that some direction, the because of the symmetry, the electrons are energy bands are energetically degenerated. That is why 2 bands are together there at this point, and then they are this degeneracy is lifted in this gamma x direction here. That is why we are see 4 band here 2 bands here, like that. At the Fermi level, there is some bands are crossing. That is why aluminium is also metal like that. Okay, so I want to just give some idea about how the band structure and all these things. Okay, then there are some difference there. For example, you take silicon, there you fill the energy levels, topmost occupied level will be the gamma point, but then the unoccupied bottommost conduction band level will be in between gamma to x as the another point. Okay, then valence band maxima, this one, this is conduction band minima. These are two different points in the valence zone. Then this is called indirect band gap material. Okay, so on the other hand, gallium arsenide, the valence band maxima and conduction band minima are the same K point. Then this is called the direct band gap material. Why I am introducing this one is the optical properties will be changed depending upon whether the material is a indirect band gap or direct band gap material. We are always prefer to have a direct band gap material because optical transitions are momentum conserving. So then you know the high quantum efficiency will be there if we use a direct band gap material. If we indirect band gap material, we have to excite electron from valence band maxima, then it will go to the same K point here. Then it is higher energy. Some other unoccupied energy levels are there in the lower energy. Then the electron decelerate. Then this will transfer some of this energy to in the form of phonon and heat the solid. And then it will arrive in the conduction band minima. Then some non-radiative transition will occur in the case of indirect band gap material. That is the reason why the heavy quantum emissions will be reduced. So if you want to make lasers and high efficiency solar cell, then we have to look for direct band gap material, not the indirect band gap material like silicon that currently we are using. That is not a good material for efficient solar cell. Okay, then you people want to know the connection between the band structure and density of states. Okay, here this is the band structure. We are plot of silica, tin dioxide. This is one of the transparent conducting oxide. There then we plot as a function of K vector, this electron energy level, then we will get band dispersion or electronic structure or electron band structure here. Then then here where the band start, there the density is also start. Okay, where it end, here it will end. Okay, here there is no band, then there is no dots here. Then here and again some band form, dots will present here, like that it will be plotted. Then there is a band gap, then here there is a band gap will be there. Okay, this is valence band maximum, this is conduction band minima. Okay, then this curve is nothing but number of electron energy states per unit energy interval. This having a large intensity means that in a particular energy, you know, here the y-axis is energy, here also the y-axis is energy. Okay, so then here you get a large intensity means here large number of electron energy states are available in this particular energy, like that we will see. That means here we will have a very narrow band or more electron energy bands there. Then only we can accommodate more number of electron energy states in a small energy interval, so that this will have a higher intensity. Then we integrate this curve, that will give number of electrons in this system. Suppose I integrate this curve from the bottom of the valence band up to the Fermi level, then I will get a total number of valence electron in the system. Okay, so now I have given some idea about the conduction band in band structure and density of states. If you have a degenerate band or a narrow band, then we will get a high intensity peaks in the DAS curve. Okay, these things you should remember. Okay, so then now we will put this solid in a some quantum confinement. In a bulk material, the dots will be go something like this, parabolic like that. Then we make a some two-dimensional material, then you get a some step like feature. Then you make a one-dimensional nanowire and like that, one-dimensional nanotubes, like then we will get a dots something like that. Instead of that, we make some quantum dots and like nano clusters like that. Then it will form some discrete energy quantum levels similar to molecular states or atomic states like that. With the higher intensity, this will be there because in small energy interval, that much number of electron we want to accommodate. So then large density of states will be present in the small energy interval when we are going to the quantum confined state like that. The dots will change with crystal structure, chemical composition and dimensionality, you know, nanomaterial or mesoporous material or it is in the interface or surfaces, depend upon that the electronic band structure change and the density is also change. Okay, so the another aspect is that, you know, you take transition metal, you know, we will have a one S band and 5D bands will be there. okay, totally you can accommodate 12 electron, then you know from lower energy to higher energy field. Compared to nickel, copper will have one more electron, so then the Fermi level will shift to higher energy, so that some of the unoccupied levels here will be occupied. So this is the density of states for nickel and copper. This sharp peak, this is from 3d electron, and this broad one is coming from 4s electrons. Okay, so this is the density of states. Okay, then whether this band structure, whatever things I am showing, this is purely a theoretical concepts, or it is experimentally measurable. So it is experimentally measurable quantity. So then, you know, that can be measured using angle resolved photoemission spectroscopy. Then, you know, in order to measure this one, you want a single crystal of the sample. Then you orient this one in a particular orientation. Then, you know, here we have seen band structure, okay, gamma 2 is it is along 001 direction, okay. Then you orient the crystal along that 001 direction will be exposed to the radiation. Then you measure the spectra. Then, you know, as a function of energy you measure, then you will get as a function of energy, you get the peaks, then you will get different points. Then you move another one in the real space, that is equivalent to the reciprocal phase here, then we can get. Then, you know, this continuous line is obtained from the density functional based calculation. Then these circles are the measured from angle resolved photoemission spectroscopy. You see there is a one-to-one correspondence between experiment and theory. But experimentally, theoretically, to calculate this spectra will take now within few minutes you can measure it. But theoretically, experimentally, you want to do it, then you want impurity free, good quality single crystal with appropriate surface treatment, etc., to measure this one. Okay, so that is why we want to do theoretical calculation sometime. Okay, then I already mentioned band gap is underestimating in the traditional density functional theory calculation. I want to show some example here. Okay, if you do Hartree-Fock calculation will include exchange, but it will not include a correlation effect at all. Then this is called the Hartree-Fock method. That will give band gap of silicon around 6 CV or more like that. Okay, so then you cannot use Hartree-Fock method to calculate the band gap to do anything. Then when you do a local density approximation, density functional theory, then you will get around 0.6, 0.7. Experimental value is 1.1 eV. It will underestimate nearly 40% or like that one. Okay, then you can do excite exchange. That is what we call it, a hybrid functional method. Then, you know, this continuous line is experiment. Then you will come very closer to experiment. Or you do a GW method, that use a green function method with a self energy correction, etc. Then that also give very excellent agreement with a experiment. So then what I try to say is you cannot say that density functional theory is useless to predict band gap. You want to accurately predict the band gap, then you have to go for appropriate methods implemented in the density functional theory, like a hybrid functional calculation or GW method, from there you can correctly predict the band gap value. Okay, then sometime you heard about a semi-metal. A good example for semi-metal is graphite. You know, usually if you have a semiconductor or insulator, there will be a gap. But in the case of semi-metal, the band gap will be zero. Okay, exactly, completely filled valence band and completely empty conduction band. Then between that, there will be no gap. Then if you see some band structure like that, then this is called semi-metal. Okay, so here the calculated band gap of various material using GW approximation compared with the experiment is shown here. Okay, the filled ones are experimental value. The square one are from GW method. Okay, the triangle one is LDA. Then when we do GW correction, we are able to get quantitatively the band gap value. But unfortunately, the computation involved is very huge, but it is doable. We can predict the band gap of the material also. Okay, so here I show some typical example of system where the band gap problem is. Indium arsenide, it is coming experimental band gap of 0.41 eV. When you do LDA calculation, it will show metal, you know, see some bands are crossing and partial filled band is there. Then you do GGA, again it will give metallic behavior. but you do hybrid functional calculation, this is the P3 lib functional, then you get a band gap of around 0.54 EV. It is a direct band gap material. This is also experimentally confirmed, okay? So people distinguish the direct band gap and indirect band gap material experimentally. I will show something about the density of CS. I already told you integrate that DAS curve, you can get number of electrons in this system can be obtained. If you integrate from 0 to up to Fermi level, Fermi level is the topmost occupied energy level, then the N of E is the density of CS multiplied by Fermi Dirac distribution function with the energy dE, then we will get the number of electron energy CS. Then we want to calculate the density of CS as a function of energy. Then, you know, usually we will calculate the band structure as a function of K. In an electron energy level, I is the band index, K is the K path or wave vector. Then this usually we call band structure. Then, you know, we will take the per unit energy interval, what is there, and then we will calculate this one in the whole Brillouin zone, you know, summation over the whole Brillouin. We will take different K points and calculate the eigenvalues in the irreducible part of the Brillouin zone, and then evaluate this function, then plot energy versus this D, then we will get the density of states. That is called number of electron energy states per unit energy interval. It high means more density of electron states there in that particular energy like that. Then some analysis purpose, like analyzing the chemical bonding and then understand the optical transition from which states to which states. We want to sometimes get projected density of states, or that is the side projected, or angular momentum projected, like S states, B states, D dots, like that project, or orbital projected, like PX, PY, PZ, like the projector, then we have to do this kinds of this particular summation. There in a pi of L is the atomic like function multiplied by this solid function like Pontron wave function. Then with this energy interval, then we sum over the entire Brillouin zone, we will be able to get the atom or site projected densities also. I will show some example. Graphene, that is one of the famous system. We just take one monolayer of carbon atom from the graphite, then we will end up with the graphene. Okay, this is kind of very simple band structure, and you know it is a zero band gap material. That is why you know there is no gap separating the valence band, the conduction band. When we plot the density of states should be look like that. Zero is the Fermi level. Then at the Fermi level, there is no gap there. You know it is exactly merged. Then you see there are some peaks there. This is called the Van Gogh singularity, like that they say. That is that is originating from some flat band present in the system around 5-6 CV range. We will have some several bands are there, some degenerate bands are there. This contribute to this peak in the density of states. That means this particular energy range, there is a large number of electron states there in this particular energies there. Okay, so then this is also important to understand the optical excitation process. If we have more electron energy states in one particular energy range is there, then you know more electron will be excited in this particular energy to higher energy levels. So then correspondingly more optical transition will be possible in that particular energy, then it will contribute to higher optical absorption and etc. That is possible. Okay, so then we have broad band is there, you know, each band I already told 2 electron there. Then the density states will be like this, with intensity will be low, that will present in a large energy range. You know, it is a broad means large energy range, these electrons are distributed. Then you there is a 1-to-1 correspondence between the band structure and density states. This is the 2-dimensional Brillouin zone of this graphene like lattice. Here it is a Crookshanks lattice. Okay, then we project out the orbital projected way. These carbon atom electrons are there. We have S electron. They are well localized. They usually not at all participate any chemical bonding to form this kinds of lattice. Then we have PX and PY electron. They are along this XY plane. They are strongly bonded with the neighboring oxygen, then they are exactly same distance PX and PY there. So then they will have exactly same DAS distribution will be there. That is why PX and PY will be same features will be there. But a PZ perpendicular to the plane, there is nothing to overlap, and then that electron energy level will be different. That is why this green will be energetically the higher energy, and that will be different. Usually this PX and P electron also very lower in energy, they will also not participate the electrical conductivity, etc. Only the PZ electrons are important to contribute the electrical properties of graphene. Okay, so like that we can analyze the physical properties of the materials from the band structure and the total and partial tensile stress. Okay, this is the, you sum all these things, you will end up with this total tensile stress. You integrate from minus 20 to 0 of this curve, you will get a total number of valence electron present in this graphene system. Okay, here we have silicon. Okay, I have given corresponding band structure. You see here we have a very flat band and also some degenerate band there. Correspondingly, we have some short peaks there. Okay, you take the derivative of this dE by dK, that will be have zero. That is why they call Van Gogh singularity when we get this kind of peak in the density of states curve. Okay, so then there is a gap. Correspondingly, here we will have a band gap will be there. Okay, so here I have shown the band density states of silicon. There is a band gap. Then aluminium is a metal. This is only sp solid. Then s orbital and b orbitals are overlap very much. Then we will get a very broad band. Then we will get a nice broader feature in the dust curve. The silver, we will have d electron. D electrons are localized. Then they are degenerate. Then we will get very sharp features in the dust curve. We will get even we have localized electron system like nanomaterials or d electron or f electron system or molecular like solids, etc. Nanowires and etc. Okay. So then whether this tensile stress is measurable quantity, yes, this can be measured using photo emission spectroscopy like that. In the intensity will be related to density of states and the Fermi-Dirac distribution function, and this is related to, you know, H cross omega is the incoming photon energy, phi is the work function of the solid, that you know how much energy required to remove electron from the outermost shell to the vacuum level, that is the work function. Then the kinetic energy of the outgoing electron, this is there, and these things are there. So from this we can able to subtract, and we will able to get the background subtracted, then we will get the tensile stress curve. Then this can be compared with the experimental value. Okay, so here I have now again showing silicon. This is a indirect band gap material because valence band maxima is at gamma point, conduction band minima is in between gamma to x point. So it is a indirect band gap material. On the other hand, gallium arsenide, it is a direct band gap material. So whether we can see experimentally a material is a direct band gap material or an indirect band gap material, yes, we can see, because if you have a direct band gap material, you know, the optical excitations are momentum conserving. Okay, so then initial K and final K are same, then optical transition will be intense, then we will have sharp absorption energy will be obtained if we have direct band gap material. Okay, so that is why gallium arsenide, the absorption start very sharp and large optical absorption will be there. So that is why you build a solar cell material with the gallium arsenide, that will have a higher optical higher efficiency than silicon. Silicon is an indirect band gap material, so then the optical absorption will start slowly and then it will saturate like that. So then from the optical absorption measurements, we can distinguish a material is direct or indirect band gap. That can be visualized or compared easily by doing DFT calculation. These are DFT results. Okay, so here you remember that I have plotted the band structure in a one dimension along certain high symmetry point. But you know, actually band structure is a three-dimensional object. Then you have to plot kx, ky, kz, what is the value of the electron's energy level. That is difficult to visualize. That is why we are doing in a one-dimensional visualization like that. Here they have given at the conduction band edge the band structure given, that energy contour is given in a three-dimensional way, that is a spherically symmetry. That means the electron along x, y, z, it will have a same momentum will be there in the case of silicon, in this case of gallium arsenide. In the case of silicon, you know, the optical electrical conductivity will be anisotropic along xy, you will get one value, and along z one value. That is why you plot the conduction band minima, that particular energy band, you will get ellipsoid in the case of silicon, because there is anisotropy in the electrical conductivity due to band dispersion along a different direction will be different. So then the effective mass of the electron will be different along the different direction in the case of silicon. But in the case of gallium arsenide, it is same along the all the direction. Okay. So then we see experimental is gap. Sometime we will measure through the electrical conductivity. As a temperature dependent electrical conductivity measurement, we will calculate the band gap, that is called thermal gap, like that. Then you do a optical absorption measurement like what I have shown here. Then you know where the optical absorption start, you interpolate that, it will be around 1.1 eV there, it will here around 1.4 eV, the band gap. This is coming from optical absorption, this is optical gap. These are two different, both are not same. I will tell you little later what this. Then also the effective mass of electron and effective mass of holes are also will be different. The reason is that the band, you know, slope of these curves are different in the valence band maxima and conduction band minima. So then obviously then the effective mass is derived from secondarity of energy with respect to K. That will be, value will also vary. That is why this effective mass also change. Then also we will have more than one band will be crossed in the band edges. Then we will have more than one electron and hole band will be there. And then multiple electron packet, hole packet will be there. They are also anisotropy. I have shown silicon will have an anisotropic behavior. Then we will have a non-parabolic band. Okay, if you have free electron, then there is no external potential acting on that. Then you will get nice parabolic band. But the real solid, there are potential, like periodic potential acting on that. Then a different direction, the electron field, different potential. Then the band is no more a parabolic band. Okay. So then when we do optical excitation, the electron go excite from valence band, that is occupied states to unoccupied states, from valence band to conduction band. So then, you know, this is a momentum conserving. So then usually the, you know, you have flat band, then only the optical excitation will be there. If you have broad band, then there number of states will be minimum, then optical excitation intensity will be negligible small, then the flat band effect only important, that is they call parallel band effect. So even though the band gap is between the valence band maxima and conduction band is this value, this is the band gap, the optical gap will be from this to this excitation, then that will be usually higher. Okay, this is one parameter, how the shape of the bands in the band edges, that will decide the optical excitation process, and then optical gap may be different from the gap obtained from the band structure or the thermal gap what we obtain. Then the second one is the optical excitations are follow selection rule. Okay, if this electron are from the S states, this electron also from S states, S to S transitions are forbidden, then this optical excitation will not be happen. Then next higher energy, some P states are there, S to P states are optical transition are possible, then you will see optical absorption of higher than the real band gap, what you see from the band structure thing. Okay. So then another one is the magnetism. Okay, if you have a non-magnetic material, the band structure and DAS will be essentially same for the majority spin electron and the minority spin electron. But if you have a magnetic system, then you have a spin polarization is there, exchange splitting will be there. The DAS of the majority spin will be different from DAS of the minority spin. Okay, so then you integrate this DAS, you will get up to Fermi level, you get one occupation number. Integrates the minority spin DAS, you will get another occupation number. You take the difference between these two occupation number, you will get the magnetic moment present in that particular atomic size you will get. Okay, then the DAS is different, band structure is also obviously different. Okay, if you take non-magnetic ion, you get your band structure and the DAS like this. If you have a magnetic, ferromagnetic ion, then you get a DAS up in one DAS, a downspin another DAS. Then band structure also two different band structure you will get. You know, here the majority spin channel, narrow bands are here below the Fermi level, but the minority spin, the majority spins are the narrow band and deep bands are above the Fermi level. Because of that, here narrow band is here, the other spin channel, it is above the Fermi level there. Okay, this contribute to these peaks in the DAS. There is one-to-one correspondence. Once you know the DAS, you can even calculate the magnetic moment by integrating this curve. So I give you a lot of informations now. Okay, so then sometime you hear about half metal. What is that? You take a magnetic material, then you plot the DAS for the majority spin and minority spin. Then in the majority spin, you will say there is a overlap, there is a partially filled band there, there is a finite density of states at the Fermi level there. That means it is a metal in the majority spin. The minority spin, there is a gap separating the valence band from the conduction band by a finite gap. Then this is called off metal. That is one spin channel, it will conduct electricity, and one spin channel, it will be like an insulator. Okay, these kinds of materials are used in spintronic devices. So suppose you take this off metal and pass on electricity, there the electron will be in the majority spin and minority spin. Then only one spin channel alone, the electrical conduction will be there. Other spin channel, it will be blocked. Then this material will be behave like a spin filter. Only you can get one particular majority spin electron alone come out of this material when we use this material to conduct the current. Okay. So now we will look some aspects of optical transition. Optical transition in crystals have to conserve both energy as well as wave vector. Okay, you take some photon with particular energy, then this particular energy will be absorbed by the electron in the conduction band. Then the same k, the same wave vector, then the electron will be excited and go to the unoccupied states, that is the valence band states. So then initial and the finite states will be the have a same k wave vector will be there. Okay, so that is because of that the optical transition should to be direct or vertical transition. Okay, these are momentum conserving, that is there. Okay, then they should follow the selection rule. Then we have to consider whether that particular, even though you know this the both momentum conservation is there and particular energy, there are some band states are there, whether they are the selection rules fulfilled, then only they are allowed, optical transition is allowed, otherwise the optical transition is forbidden. Okay, when we want to calculate the optical property, then these features should be accounted in our equations. Okay, already I told we now have band structure obtained from DFT calculation. Then the band structure contain where the electrons are energetically present in the momentum space. Then also we know each band, what kinds of character band is there. So then all informations are there in the band structure. Now we have to appropriately account those things to evaluate the optical transition. Okay. So usually what we will do, we take a band structure and the wave function. Then we know the photon energy of omega, for that particular energy, how much optical transitions are possible. Then particular energy difference between the initial state is nothing but the valence band, and the finite state is the conduction band. Then this energy difference, conduction band, valence band energy difference minus the omega. Then this is zero, means the delta function have a value of finite. Then fulfill this condition, then we assume that there is an optical transition there for that particular k point. Like that, various k points we have to calculate this allowed transition and sum it for that particular energy. Then we will calculate the epsilon 2. This is imaginary part of optical absorption or absorptive part of optical dielectric function that we can obtain here. Okay, here. This is summation over the whole Brillouin zone. Dk is the k space. We will do the integration. Then this is a wave function for the conduction band, and this is valence band. P is the momentum matrix element that take care of S to P or P to D, or the selection rules are fulfilled or not. That will be accounted this one. Through that we will calculate the imaginary part. Okay, once we know the imaginary part, we can calculate the real part of optical dielectric tensor using the imaginary part, using this Kramer-Kronig relation shown here. This involves integration going from 0 to infinity. So then you have to calculate this one for a very high energy. Okay, how we calculate then the higher energy we want to calculate, I mean we have to account lot of unoccupied and lower energy electronic states also accounted, then only we are able to calculate these two functions in a very high energy. Okay, once we know the real part and imagined part of dielectric function, you can able to calculate all the other linear optical property like refractive index, extinction coefficient, reflectivity, absorption coefficient, electron energy loss function, all these properties can be obtained. Okay, so then we actually, when in the real system, when you excite a electron from the valence band to conduction band, there is a hole and an electron will be formed. Then a electron hole pair will be there, that is a exciton will be there. This exciton will form bring some bound states. Those things are not accounted in our present calculation. Okay, just we excite electron from valence band to conduction band and calculate, do the summation and calculate the imaginary part dielectric function using this relation. Here this is D is the dipole operator account for the momentum matrix element taking care of the selection rules. Okay, so if we have band, then we will have well dispersed band, then you know number of electron energy states in a energy interval will be less, then the optical absorption will be less intense. If in, on the other hand, if you have a quantum confined system like nanomaterial etc., then we have a discrete energy level, you know, each discrete initial stage and final stage have a large states in a, then we will have a very intense optical absorption will happen in a very certain energy intervals due to this quantum confinement effect. Okay, that is the main difference you will see from the bulk material with the nanomaterial. Okay, then usually the you look the semiconducting materials what we use, the atomic case you will have s electron localized and p electron will be above that, they will be present like that. Then they form sp3 hybridization, then we will have molecule like that, then we will have some bonding antibonding states will be formed for s and p electron, then we get then the form a solid, then we have localized s bonding states and then antibonding states of p states and antibonding states of s states will be there in the valence band and the conduction band. Okay, this is p state and this is s state, then this is no, delta L should be odd number, then P to S transitions are allowed transition, then optical excitation will start from the band edge itself. That is one of the reason why with the band optical absorption measurement you do, where the optical absorption start, that is corresponding to the band gap of the semiconducting material. This is now necessary, always necessary to fulfill like that. In certain material, maybe the valence band maxima and conduction band minima have a same band character like the either S character or P character or D characters, then this optical transitions are forbidden, then band gap will be the optical band gap will be different from the band gap obtained from the band stretches. Okay, so here I have given some calculated imaginary part of optical dielectric function. This we have done in 1997 I think, when I was a postdoc in Uppsala. Okay, this is some lead chalcogenide material with narrow band gap. Then these materials are used in IR detector and etc. Their optical property, optical absorption spectra is already measured experimentally using elliptometry measurement. Then we the combined experiment and the theory for lead telluride and selenide, and you can see that there is a good agreement between the experiment and theory. Okay, there is some intensity variation is there, that is due to temperature effect, instrument resolution, light time effect, all these things are there. Those things are not properly considered, even though we have done some broadening effect in our theoretical calculation. Okay, otherwise it is giving good agreement. Okay, so then we have, I already told, there is a one-to-one corresponding between the band structure and the optical absorption coefficient. Okay, if you plot the band structure of silicon, this is the indirect band gap, it is shown here, and then we measure the optical absorption spectra, you see some peaks, E1, E2, like that, some characteristics peaks there in the case of silicon. Okay, these are coming from, this is some narrow band. Okay, this narrow band here also, where narrow band is there, then vertical things there, large initial state and large final state there, then lot of optical transition absorption will take place in this particular energy difference. Okay, that is around 3.2 EV, and another one here, that is 4.23 EV. With this place, you will get a band, some peaks in the optical absorption. Okay, so I want to just give you some feeling about the connection between the band charger and the optical absorption you measure from ellipsometric measurement. Okay, optical measurement is one of the good technique. Yes, it will contain not only the electronic energy levels, but also the character of the band. Okay, so then you calculate the optical absorption spectra, then you consider both, you know, band position and what kinds of character this band, all these things are accounted in the optical spectra. And if it agree experiment and theory very well, means we can conclude that the calculated optical, the electronic structure, the energy levels are good agreement, also the character of each band also consistent between real experimental thing and theory, like that we can do. So here the another case, the germanium, and you know, then here you see this is the experimental value, this is a theoretical value, there are some substantial differences there. You know, experimental band gap will be usually small, so then optical absorption start in one lower energy in the case, that is it is started a very lower energy in the theoretically, experimentally higher energy. Then I told already the excitonics effects in the optical absorptions are not considered in traditional optical calculation from tensor functional theory. So those are there in the experiment, it is lacking, that is why there is a difference in the intensity at the lower energy parts, usually it is like that. Okay, so here the typical comparisons are made between silicon optical absorption spectra between experiment and theory. This is the experimental spectra, green one is theory. Because the theory underestimates the band gap, so that is why optical absorption start low. Okay, so then maybe sometime people what do, they correct the band gap underestimate by just shifting this band to here. Then automatically, then obviously, then this peak will come here, but the intensity of this peak again low, then this peak will be obviously shifted here. So then this huge difference is mainly the band gap underestimated here in this case. Okay, so then that we corrected with new approaches like excite exchange, hybrid functional, GW approximation. Then we can able to get this peak and this peak in the correct position, but the first peak intensity will be low. Then we have to account the excitonic effect. Then how we can consider that one? What is first we want to know excitonic effect? This is a electron hole pair interaction. When you excite an electron from valence band to conduction band, a hole will be created in the valence band and an electron will be created in the conduction band. They will have some attractive potential. Due to this attractive potential, they create some virtual bound states just above, just below the conduction band. Usually optical transition start from valence band maxima to conduction band minima. Now because of creation of this virtual excitonic energy levels, so then optical absorption start even in lower energy. How we can prove that one? You take gallium arsenide, you measure the optical absorption measurement, you see the lower energy, there is some peak at a lower temperature. Then you increase the temperature, the electron hole attractive interaction, this they will electron hole will be dissociate in the dissociate, then there will be no exciton will be there at high temperature. Then this peak will be disappear at a room temperature, there is no peak at all. Okay, so then this is spurious peak coming here is coming from this virtual bound states created by the excitonic energy level. So this is also nowadays people do include using solving Pethe-Salpeter equation, including the excitonic effect in the DFT calculation, but it is computationally very 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 extensive. You know, it takes maybe several weeks instead of a few hours or few minutes calculation with the traditional DFT calculation. Here the compared results are there. You know, the continuous one is the experiment. This one is the dash one is theory. Okay, here band gap correction is accounted, but you know this intensity variation is there in the lower energy and the also higher energy range. This is coming from the excitonic effect. When we account the excitonic effect, the dash and continuous experimental curve and theoretical curves are quantitatively also agreeing very well. This is done for silicon, germanium, and gallium arsenide. So what I am trying to say is, we can even considered quantitatively predict the optical properties of material from DFT calculation, but it involves more effort and you have to do additional effort to be done to calculate the calculation. Okay, so sometimes you want to analyze the experimental optical spectra, then what kinds of optical excitation process happen. Then people ignoring the momentum matrix element, just from the band searcher, from the occupied to unoccupied, all the available energy states, they calculate. Then this is called joint density assays. That is integration through the blind zone, all the energy transition with the energy difference of h cross omega, that we will account as a function of omega. We plot this function, then this is called joint density assays. Okay, then we have real epsilon to omega spectra, that is optical absorption spectra there. Then we can compare both. Then you know there is some peak here, this is lacking there, means then this is coming from some forbidden transition, you know, that is we have not accounted the momentum matrix element to evaluate this one, that is this peak is there. When we account that one, that is we are accounting the selection rule, then that may be disappear. Then like that we can go more detail to analyze the optical spectra. Okay, so then this is for the semiconductor and the insulator. When we have metal, then there are free electrons, then the free electron will participate in the intra band. Then you know that is inter band optical transition from valence band to conduction band. Here the intra band within the band at the Fermi level, those will also contribute to the lower energy part of the optical spectra. That is from the up to 2 electron volt, usually this intra band contribution to the optical spectra will be there. That can be obtained through some free electron route like MAR-TAM. There we have something called plasma frequencies. This is called screen plasma frequency obtained coming from the collective excitation of the free electron in the metals. That is related to number of valence electron in the system. Okay, then easily it can be estimated. Then we are explicitly plotting the band structure from the Fermi surface integration. We can able to theoretically calculate this plasma frequency. Then from that we can calculate the imaginary part of optical dielectric function coming from intra band contribution also, that is there in the case of metal. Then we can compare the experiment and theory for metals also, the optical property. Here they compare the optical properties of this platinum as a function of energy, the reflectivity spectra done. You know, this circular and triangular experiment, this continuous curve is the theory. One means 100% reflective, then it is going like that. So you know, usually you do traditional ellipsometry measurement, the measurements can be done up to 5 eV or something. But you want to do beyond that energy, you have to go synchrotron radiation to measure this reflectivity spectra. But theoretically, it doesn't matter. I can do 5 eV or 25 eV. I can do it in the same computer with the same code. Okay, that is some of the advantage of using a theoretical calculation to produce the spectra. Not only that, you know, you prepare a sample that have impurity that will be reflect the optical property. But you do theory, you will do a pristine sample, or you can introduce a specific impurity and simulate the spectra. Then you can get more insight about the properties of a specific material with that. Okay, the another aspect is the optical anisotropy. Okay, if you have a cubic crystal, all the direction you get the same optical spectra. But all the other rest of the 6 class of sample, you will have a anisotropy in the optical spectra is there. Let us take some hexagonal sample like graphite. There in a XY plane, we have strong covalent bonding. Between the plane, we have van der Waals bonding. Then the band dispersion and optical anisotropy, everything will be there. Here the graphite, you know, perpendicular to this plane, the optical imaginary part is shown here, parallel to the plane. You have the thing there, you know, there is a huge difference between parallel and perpendicular to the plane, the optical absorption spectra. That indicates that this material is having large optical anisotropy. Okay, so I have given some basic idea about what is band structure, how it is evolved, what is the density of states, how we can estimate optical properties, etc. With this idea, I will apply these things for real state of the art new class of material. So we want to work on a material, a new class of material with the efficiency higher than that. Then we want to predict new material with high optoelectronic good optoelectronic property useful for solar cell application. Okay, people are working on various generation of solar cell material. the next generation solar cell material should have a higher efficiency and the modular cost should be low, so that the dollar per watt power will be lower, so that it will be wide scale use. Okay, this is a, you know, now current technology around $1 per watt power. We want to go from this to next generation. It is $0.03 per kilowatt hour or $0.3 per watt hour, like that. This technology we want to go. Then we want to find material with the cheap, environmental friendly, at the same time they will have a high modular efficiency. Okay, for that they set up several goals. Then in 2010 the price is 52 cents, means it will be 2030 it is projected to be 5 cents, so that it can be mass way we can utilize. That is 10 times we have to reduce the solar module cost. That is what it means. Okay, we used to see traditionally silicon. Silicon is an indirect band gap material. I already told, to process silicon you have to consume so much energy. Okay, that is the main reason why even though silicon is an abundant element, then the preparation and making a wafer and all these things cost a lot. That is, and also its optical absorption is low. Instead of that, we have having gallium arsenide having direct band gap and high optical absorption coefficient, then that is having higher optical efficiency. But unfortunately, gallium arsenide is very, very expensive. So then we have to find some new material that should be low temperature processable, so that the energy consumption during the production will be low. Then also it is earth abundant, and so that it can be wide way use it. So that is why there is now a new class of material called perovskite solar cell materials. They aim. Those materials are recently, 2010 only invented, but their efficiency now more than 22% efficiency they have achieved on this material. So then we take a traditional silicon. On top of that, these materials are coming band gap 2 eV or more. Then we put it as a tandem cell. We can improve the efficiency of the material. Then we aim for this kinds of configuration. We bottom cell traditional silicon, on top of that we put some silicon perovskite solar cell to design new material for solar cell application. Then also the perovskite currently using is lead based material. That is, lead is toxic. The people in Europe and other Western countries want to avoid all toxic material in public use devices. So then we want to replace lead with some non-lead based material. So with this concept, we wrote a proposal and we got a CSR project, and people are working on new perovskite material that can be used for this kinds of tandem solar cell. We aim to get a new generation solar cells. Okay, so they have worked out the efficiency can be traditional solar silicon 19.4% efficiency. We add the on top of that perovskite cell, we can increase the efficiency by 25%. Then we can reduce the cost by from 0.79 watt to 0.67 watt, like that they are telling. Okay, so then you want to tune the band gap. Sometime you want to tune. In order to tune the band gap, you can do DFT calculation. From that we can identify how you want to increase the band gap or decrease the band gap, what kinds of elements should be added. Here they have done systematically replace some of the lead with the tin in methylamine lead diodide. Then it is pure material is coming 2.3, you can tune the band gap value like that. Okay, so by yes, this lead side they can substitute. The problem is then when we add a tin, the band gap is reduced. Then unfortunately quantum efficiency is not good, so that but the tin is not toxic, but tin substituted system is not having as good as the lead based toxic material. Okay, so then people take methylamine lead iodide, then substitute iodide size with bromine, then they can tune the band gap from 1.6 to 2.2 eV. But again lead is there. Okay, so we want to avoid the lead, so then we have to find a completely new material. These materials are called hybrid material, because here CH3NH, this is organic. Lead iodide, these are inorganic. Okay, organic and inorganic together form a perovskite like system. Then this is called hybrid solar cell. then there is a possibility of replacing some of this organic molecule with something new. That is what we tried to do. People already tried with the lead side with it, other divalent cation like tin, copper and etc. But the efficiency is decreased. That is the reason we are unable to use. Okay, so with this idea, we have replaced the methylamine, that is in a CH3, NH3, or a formamide, that is here, KCNH2. These are the two organic molecules so far experimentally tried and synthesized the sample. Now we have found some other new molecule called cyclopropene. This molecule can be also be accommodated in this in saprosite lattice. Then we design some new solar cell. Then one of the basic quantity you obtain from DFT method is the total energy. Then you assume various crystal structure, this particular composition process, then optimize the structure and get the total energy. Among that, which structure is lowest energy, then we can say pretty tell that this particular new material will possess that particular crystal structure. So in order to do that, we took 90 different trial structure. From that, we solved the crystal structure, predict the crystal structure of this cyclopropene, tin iodide and lead iodide system. One is in the coxonal structure and another one is the monoclinic structure and phase group, atom position, everything is we have predicted. Then this is the crystal structure, this organic molecule cyclopropene is here and like that it is there. It is highly distorted structure, lattice parameter, atom position, heat of formation, everything is we have done. These are the stable compound, that is what we found. Then we can plot the band structure. Okay, this material is a direct band gap material. We are in a valence band maximum and conduction band minimum are the same point. Then that is good thing. Okay, compared to silicon, one can expect this material will have a high optical absorption. That is one of the good things needed for using a material for higher efficiency solar cell. Then when we plot the orbital projected denser phase, carbon and hydrogen form organic molecule. Because of the molecule, then we will have very narrow discrete energy level, like molecular like levels form from carbon and hydrogen. On the other hand, iodine and tin form some kinds of octahedras. Then there will be overlap interaction is there. That is why they form a well dispersed band like this. So that is why we have broad bands. DAS is there and broad band features are coming from this iodine and lead atoms or the tin atom. Then when we plot the orbital projected DAS, then we found another one important observation. The valence band maxima is coming from tin or lead states. That means if you excite an electron, a hole will be created in the tin side. Then when we have conduction band minima, is originating from carbon 2p iodine and lead 5p states. Then the p electron states, s2p optical transition is allowed. So then electron will be there mainly in the p states of the carbon and iodine, etc. But the hole will be there, the tin. That means you excite electron one present in one atom, hole present in the other atom. That means they are physically, spatially separated in the lattice. That means it will reduce the recombination rate of this system. So then more electron and holes will be well separated and they will be available for photoelectron conversion things. Then this kinds of material, one can expect high quantum efficiency of this new class of material. Then another important quantity of interest is the carrier mobility. Okay, if you excite an electron from valence band to conduction band through photoelectron, then some photoelectron generated photons. So the photoelectron generator, then it should be move away from the semiconductor very fast. Otherwise, it reside there, it will be probability to meet a hole and then recombine and it will waste the energy. So then we want to have a high electron mobility and high hole mobility. That can be measured, if you calculate the mobility, the effective mass of electron and hole, then high heavy mass, mobility will be low. Okay, lower effective mass is there, then we can say this material will have a high carrier mobility. Then charge separation will be more efficient. Then this material we use as in solar cell, that will have a high photo conversion efficiency like that. Okay, so usually in the effective mass value, one means the effective mass is equal to same of the free electron mass. If it is 0.5 means it is lighter than the 0.5 times light weight than the free electron mass, like that. We usually people expect that the effective mass value is 0.5 or less than that value is there, then this material will have a higher carrier mobility will be there, then they are useful for optoelectronic devices. This newly predicted material having low effective mass, you know, this effective mass can be measured from the slope of this bands at the band edges, and then this is a very small value indicating high carrier mobility. Then the other things we want to calculate the optical absorption. Especially we want to get the optical absorption around the visible part of the solar spectrum, where the maximum energy is present in the solar spectra. Okay, in these materials, optical absorption is reasonably high in the visible part of the solar spectrum, and then good optical absorption is there, high carrier mobility is there, electron and holes are well separated in the facially, then we expect these materials will have a high quantum photo conversion efficiency, and that can be used for higher efficiency solar cells. Okay, now I will take some new task. You know, usually you look any solar cell, this is not a pure silicon alone we will use. We will use several layers will be there, like electron transport layer, hole transport layer, ion reflection coating, electrode, like that, various layers will be added. Then when you add layers to the various layers and form a heterostructure, there will be interface will be formed from the active absorbing semiconducting material and the layers introduced there. So here recently, then a cesium titanium bromide, they found reasonably good optical solar conversion efficiencies there. Then there they use a titanium dioxide as a electron transport layer. Then we want to study the interface between these two material, that how it will be influence the optoelectronic properties. Okay, so then we calculated the optical properties of titanium dioxide, cesium titanium bromide, and the heterostructure created like this with the titanium dioxide and the cesium titanate, this heterostructure like that. You know, this band gap at the heterostructure is changed. That is one thing. You know, titanium dioxide having a very well broad bands. That is the one reason why it is used as a electron transport layer in the semiconductor material. But this active material having a very narrow band. Because of the narrow band, high optical absorption will be there, but the carrier mobility will not be as good. When we form an interface, there again we get a very narrow bands will be formed at the band edges, like that it is present. Then we look at the band edges, okay, of the heterostructure. This is the, you know, at the interface, we should have type 2 like band edges there, that will be attached edges. Also, the band edges of the valence band edge of the two layers should not be far away from each other. That can be measured in terms of offset, band offset, valence band offset, and conduction band offset. These things to be small so that, you know, electron or hole generated in the one layer will be easily transferred to the other layer if this difference should be minimum. Okay. But in this case, the valence band offset is high, that is 1.28 eV. Then in the hole transfer, it will be very slow. Electron transfer will be reasonably efficient, like that it will be there. Then we calculate the optical properties of the pure material, electron transport layer, and then the heterostructure. You know, pure material having large optical absorption, when we form a heterostructure, this is the bold one, that optical absorption will be lower than in between that of the electron transport layer and the active semiconductive layer. Okay, why the titanium dioxide is having poor optical absorption at the visible part? Because it is a wide band gap insulator. Okay, it is having a very large band gap, then it is optically transferred in the visible part, that is why it is coming very low. So then when we form a heterostructure, then the optoelectron properties get changed. Okay, here we have calculated the effective mass of the pure material for titanium dioxide well dispersed band, that is why we are getting very small electron effective mass and hole effective mass. So then it will have a high carrier mobility. But on the other hand, cesium titanium bromide, the value is higher than 1, the carrier mobility is not as high. So then the recombination rate will be reasonably there. Otherwise, this material will have a very good optical absorption is there. it will have a higher efficiency. One can expect. When we form a Ketrol structure, then you see the effective mass is very high because a narrow bands form at the band edge. So then that means the carrier mobility will be very low. Then due to this formation of these kinds of interface in the Ketrol structure, the photo conversion efficiency will be drastically reduced. Okay, this is I just want to show how when we go from pure material to some Ketrol structure, the properties can change drastically. Okay, then we have already done several and I have shown some perovskite material. Their lead is there. This perovskite solar cells are even though having high quantum efficiency, degrade easily with the environment, and all the issues are there to wide scale application. That is why we have to find some new material. This material will be non-toxic, and at the same time they should be earth abundant. Then they should have good optoelectronic efficiency to use it for higher efficiency solar cell. With all this idea in mind, using machine learning technique with various database, we collect using some descriptor, we identify a group of compound. From that, we design some new material with the anti-perovskite structure. ADL systems are perovskite. There the cation and anion were there, it are in the opposite side there, then we end up with anti-perovskite material. Okay, these kinds of anti-perovskite materials we have designed. Among that, Ca3PN alone experimentally there, that also the crystal structure is solved. They found it is an orthorhombic structure, but they don't know the space group where the atom position also they have not solved. We assumed various structure and we solved the crystal structure of calcium Ca3PN, and then this bracket value is the experimental lattice parameter. This is theoretical lattice parameter. You see very good agreement is there. Its space group we have predicted, it is orthorhombic structure with Na and O3 type crystal structure with the space group. Then we have also predicted the atom positions. Okay, so then now you get some good idea about how we can contribute to real material design purpose from Abhinisham method. Okay, this Ca3PN, we have predicted the structure and compared available experimental data. Then this is crystal structure is this. Then same crystal structure is possessed by magnesium, strontium, barium and zinc compound also. Okay, so that we have predicted structure and solved their crystal structure, equilibrium volumes listed, formation energy is negative. That means these compounds can form, stable compounds can be formed. Note that Ca3PN is already there, then other compounds are also having negative value. We can predict that these compounds will form. All these materials are direct band gap material. I already told you direct band gap materials are good for higher efficiency solar cell application because they have high optical absorption than the indirect band gap material. But unfortunately, seeing Z3PN have a indirect band gap material, even though that is also having same crystal structure as the other materials. Okay, so then the other important thing is you can have a material with the band gap varying from 0.5 to 2.8, wide range of band gap you can have materials currently at hand. Then we can, using these kinds of material, we can make a tandem solar cell where higher band gap semiconductor use the top layer and smaller band gap material in the bottom layer. In between layer, other semiconductors can be used. This is the band structure. This is a direct band gap material. You see very well dispersed band is there, that clearly indicates this will have a low effective mass will be there. Then we have done another exercise also. Okay, now I have this compound Ca3PN, for example. I replace some of the calcium with the strontium, barium or magnesium because these are all are same group, same structure. So isostructure, isoelectronic compound, then easily you can substitute one with the other. Then we have found that we can tune the band gap value. Okay, suppose I replace some barium with the strontium, then I can tune with the band gap of 1.27 or 1.12 eV or 1.38 eV. Like that, we can tune the band gap. So that means when we can make wide range of composition with the same structure, direct band gap behavior, they can be used in some tandem solar cell with appropriate band gap what we want. then we have calculated the formation energy of even in between newly in the made composition. They also have a high negative heat of formation. That indicates that those compounds also form a yes, experimentally we can synthesize. Okay, this is the DAS. Total DAS, you see there is a wide band gap. Band gap can be tuned, so then this band gap of barium compound is smaller and magnesium compound is wider, like that it is there. Then we can analyze the band structure, and you can see that strontium D states are there in the conduction band minima. Then nitrogen P and phosphorus P states are mainly there in the valence band maxima. Then P2 D optical excitations are allowed to transition. Then optical transition started the band edge itself. Then you know electron will create in the either phosphorus sites or the nitrogen site. Holes will be created in the holes will be created in the phosphorus or nitrogen sites. Electron will be created in the strontium sites. So then the electron hole pair will be well spatially well separated, and they reside in two different atoms. That will reduce the recombination rate and improve the efficiency of the system. Okay, we can visualize and analyze the chemical bonding because the charge density we will anyway obtain. Okay, between boron, barium and nitrogen and barium and phosphorus, there is a noticeable covalent bonding is there. Because of that only this broad band we are seeing the band edges. Okay, so now I calculate the optical property. Because these materials are having wide range of band gap, then in the material with the lower band gap, optical absorption start very lower energy. Material with the higher band gap, optical absorption start with the higher energy. Then with this wide range of optical absorption band gap is there. Using this, we can make tandem solar cells with the higher efficiency. New generation material can be designed. Okay, we also calculated the effective mass of this new class of material. What we have predicted, at least some direction, we are getting the band gap. The effective mass is lower than 0.5 value in these materials here. That means then you know that particular direction, the electrons and our holes will move very fast. So that at any point of time during the photo electron generation purpose, charge will not be accumulated in the system. They will be efficiently separated and harvested. So then these materials will have a high potential to use tandem solar cell application. And we have newly identified a gal from Palakkad, Sridevi. She only done this work and now submitted for publication. Okay. So now we will look for some completely new class of materials, that is a nanomaterial. Then we build some heterostructure and predict whether this can be used for excitonic solar cells. Okay, so already people done some 2D material with molybdenum disulfide with wolfram diselenide. They made some heterostructures, and then they shown that they are having high quantum efficiency, and they can be used in solar cell applications, excitonic solar cell application. Another one material they use is phosphorin. Phosphorin like a graphene, like that. Phosphorin can be obtained by mono layer of phosphorus. If we take, that is called phosphorin. This is again a direct band gap material. Interesting aspects of this material is its band gap is around 1.5 eV. That is the optimum band gap semiconductor one we want to maximum harvest solar energy from solar spectra. Okay, so then when we make heterostructures of this phosphorin with monolayer of molybdenum disulfide, we make a heterostructure. Then this form acceptor donor type 2 heterostructures, and then they are having high optical absorption. They are having optical this photo conversion efficiency is very high, up to even 20% efficiency is they predicted on this new class of material. Okay, so like that, another one group reported gallium arsenic phosphate monolayer is put on top of gallium nitride monolayer and performed various configuration of heterostructures like that. Then all these configurations also having a direct band gap material and with well dispersed band, like what I have shown some of the material earlier in the bulk material. Then they are having very low effective mass along the gamma x direction for the electron and holes. That means high carrier mobility there. All these features point toward these materials will have a could solar cell material for excitonic solar cells. Here, you know, when we may see the this band alignment, you know, electron will be excited, hole will be created here, and electron will be created here. Then electron will be present in one monolayer, hole will be present in the another layer. This is called donor and acceptor configuration. Then you know, electron and hole will be well separated by present there. This kind of things is needed for excitonic solar cell applications. Okay, so then this material also they predicted having a higher efficiency will be there like that. With this idea, then we found that why can't we take a phosphorine, that is also direct band gap material, then a black phosphorus, this arsenic phosphate, this monolayer. Then you know, this is a phosphorine monolayer, this is arsenic phosphorine monolayer, then made a ketro structure out of that and study whether it's suitability to use it in a excitonic solar cell. Okay, when we take phosphorine, its band gap is 1.55 eV. then arsenic phosphate, it is having 1.53 eV band gap is there. Okay, then we calculate the effective mass of this material also very small. You know, usually the effective mass of charge should be lower than 0.5 into free electron mass. Then in any one of the crystallography direction, then we can claim that these materials will have a high excellent carrier mobility is there like that. Okay, that is also there. Then we take arsenic phosphate monolayer, that optical absorption is like that. Phosphorine optical absorption is lower than arsenic phosphate. When we take a ketro structure of these two things, that optical absorption is higher than the individual material. Okay, then the ketro structure will have a higher optical absorption than the pure material. Okay, then this is also form a donor acceptor band alignment due to this type two band alignment present here. So then you can expect electron will be there in one layer and holes will be in the other layer in the when during the optical excitation process. This will form a excitonic solar cell can be made in this this ketro structure that what we have predicted. Okay, these are some concept based on excitonic solar cell or direct band gap material with high photo conversion efficiency. There are some new concepts are also available. You know, so far we have seen all these materials are having single band gap. So that means the incoming photon with the energy higher than the band gap, that alone can be converted into photoelectron. Lower than that, the energy will be transferred into this material. Okay, so then now we take some material there. Suppose we introduce in between the valence band maxima and conduction band minima another one band state. That band state is called intermediate band state. In this material, we can harvest the photons with the energy lower than its original band gap value also. So this way we can improve the efficiency of the solar cell. Okay, that means we can this is original photon, then some some low energy photon also can be excited, and they can also contribute to the electricity production. So this way we can improve the solar cell. So with this idea, we try to design some new material. Yes, I already told we are working on wide range of material. When we work on some new higher efficiency cathode material, we come across some new material where you know iron is replaced with the titanium. Then in a pure LiFe FeO4, we have wide band gap. When we introduce a titanium, then it introduces some intermediate band gap band between this valence band and conduction band in the this material. Okay, so then we identify some new intermediate band gap material. Then a similar way we are working on non-lithium ion batteries also, materials also like sodium ion battery material like NATMN SiO4. There when we know we take sodium manganese silicide, we desodiate, then we found that we create some intermediate band states in this material also. Okay, you know, this is a pure fully sodiated material. When we remove the sodium, then some intermediate states are formed in this material. Okay, then it fulfill the concept what I have shown you earlier. So then we vary the sodium configuration, we can vary the intermediate states position and range also. Okay, so with these all these ideas are came accidentally when we work on battery material. Then we want to intentionally design new intermediate band gap material. Then I gave this project to one master student. He took some chalcopyrite common like magnesium tin phosphate. This is a direct band gap material. Okay, you know, we are want to have a direct band gap material with well dispersed band and all these things. Then only we will have a higher quantum efficiency. So then this is a direct band gap material. Now our aim is to introduce some band, intermediate band in between that, and to see whether we can increase the optical absorption and efficiency of this material. Okay, then we take a super cell of this compound and replace some of the tin with small quantity of vanadium. Vanadium having d electrons, then this d electrons form some intermediate band. Okay, this is original band, the black. Then we substitute with tin side with vanadium, it is creating some intermediate band. Okay, whether then when we calculate the optical absorption coefficient, this is for the pure silicon, that is very low in the optical the visible range. Then we have red one is the pure material, this is a direct band gap material, so that is having reasonable optical absorption. But when we introduce an intermediate band, then you know this green one we get, that means the optical absorption coefficient increased drastically due to the introduction of this intermediate band. Okay, these are some new concepts. There is a lot of research is going on this class of new materials for new generation solar cells. These are completely new class of materials. Okay, so then we are working on hydrogen storage material also. Then magnesium dihydride is one of the potential hydrogen storage material. There usually people use titanium as a catalyst to desorb hydrogen. Then we try to substitute titanium in magnesium to study the properties. Then we depend upon the titanium substitution, it will be a insulator or metal, or also it is having a intermediate band semiconductor material, what I have shown found. You know, here when we have titanium 4 plus ion, this particular composition we introduce in between the valence band maximum and conduction band minima, we are able to introduce some intermediate band states. So then, you know, we originally we can get only this particular optical absorption also only possible. Now we are two low energy photon can be also converted into one photoelectron can be generated out of that. Okay, so then with this we have calculated the optical properties of this titanium substituted system, that is having you know, band gap is get reduced and then optical absorption start in the visible range, and this material will having a higher optical absorption due to the introduction of some intermediate band into the system. Okay, so then this materials can be used for some new generation solar cell. Yeah, these are used in photocatalysts. Okay,
okay,
so
okay,
here okay. We have take some C2N monolayers, and on then there we substitute carbon sides and nitrogen sides to tune the band gap and band edge position, to use this material to dissociate water into hydrogen and oxygen. This way we can produce fuel from the water. Okay, so this idea we have done, and study the optical properties and band edge position. Because we want to have a band gap should be greater than 1.23 eV. Then also the band edges should be strated with the redox potential of the water. Okay, so this way we have to design new material. The pure C2N having a, you know, band edges far away from the strated redox potential of water. But when we substitute carbon with the silicon or germanium, then it is coming closer to each other. Then this way will improve the efficiency of the solar cell. Okay, the band gap is reduced. That is higher than 1.23 V, not very far away from optimum value where maximum solar energy can be converted into photoelectron. So then we have this silicon substituted system will have a good photocatalyst and the pure C2N monolayer system that we have predicted. Then because the band gap is tuned, then our optical absorption will start with the substituted system even in the lower energy, and then this way we can improve the efficiency of this photocatalyst like that. Then we have done some thing on absorbing some molecule on this kind some monolayer, and see calculate the absorption energy, then how the band edges vary, and then band gap also can be tuned by absorbing some molecules on surface of this monolayer. Then this way we can identify new material, that is here iodine molecule adsorbed C2N having a good potential to use it in the photocatalyst for water reduction, like that we have found. Okay, with that I will conclude my talk. I just shown you some results on optical properties, electronic structure, and how various aspects of optical properties can be exploited to study solar cell materials, not only traditional solar cell but also tandem solar cell or hybrid solar cell or excitonic solar cell or intermediate band gap solar cell, etc. And I just informed you how we can also design photocatalyst to produce fuel out of solar energy also. Okay, with that I thank you for your kind attention.